Happy Sabbath, happy Sabbath, happy Sabbath. Welcome to everyone joining us. I would like to let you know that in just about 2 minutes, we are going to begin the program formally. But in the meantime, I'm going to ask you, if you've not already done it, to please share this program with as many people as possible. Go ahead and click the share button. If you're watching on YouTube or on Facebook, click the share button. And on YouTube, on Facebook, pardon me, please also engage the watch party feature and type in, as you are sharing your watch party, the same title that we have chosen for tonight's Bible class, and that way people will know when the notification comes up exactly what they're in for. And I will say that we are all in for a treat from God's word, because when he shares what he has to say with us, then we can be transformed by him. Now, I'd like to welcome everybody joining us, but let me get ahead of myself. I'm just warming up the room, and in just under 2 minutes, I will formally welcome us. Click the share button, and also in the meantime, go down into your comment section and type what great things the Lord has done for you. Testify. I know that some of you have been going through some trials, just as I have, and some of you have experienced triumphs. And by the fact that we are still here, that lets me know, that lets us all know that God has been good to all of us. And I just pray that we will continue to serve him. So go ahead and click the share button, and in 30 seconds, we will begin with prayer. Click the share button, and we will begin with prayer. Thank you for joining us. Yes, go ahead and testify. Has God been good to you? If he has, go ahead and click in the comment section and type yes, exclamation point, and let everybody who's watching be encouraged by your testimony. And I'd like to welcome everyone joining us. All right, let's go ahead and begin with prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for giving us a new opportunity to share in your word again, for the blessing of your Holy Spirit who teaches us. And I'm asking you now, Lord, to open up our understanding, teach us how to pray, teach us how to serve you with our entire hearts, teach us how to hear from you and not run out ahead of you without your guidance. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. And amen again. Well, I would like to welcome you formally now to the NET 2018 and Beyond Bible class we have been keeping since the beginning of 2018, which is why we have sort of marked it by that title. And we are continuing in our lesson study, if you want to call it a Bible class, part number 8, The Victorious Life, part number 8, The Victorious Life. I'd like to welcome everyone joining us on Facebook, everyone who's joining us on YouTube, everyone who is joining us on our beloved NCU TV. My name is L. David Harris. I am your host, and we will continue in our lesson study this evening under the specific caption, Victory Through Prayer. And of course, again, we have been going through a study series on the victorious life. And how can anybody say that they are victorious without prayer, right? So it almost goes without saying that there is no way that we can be victorious in Christ without prayer. Prayer is said to be where God does not come down to us, as much as he has been so kind to condescend. Emmanuel, meaning God with us, Jesus Christ took on human flesh so that we could be saved. In as much as he has done that, he condescended so that Moses could be able to commune with him in the mount and in the cloud as well. This is not the aim of prayer. It is not that God comes down to us, but that he elevates us. Just like Paul said, to be seated with Christ Jesus in heavenly places. So God is kind enough to give us a facility to connect with him in a way that is beyond any other way while we still await the coming of the Lord, while we still await our change, because one day, our God is going to change us so we can experience his presence in the fullness. So I would like to thank God really in this place here to say there are so many things that he could have just left up to chance, but he did not. He could have said, well, because you have sinned and come short of my glory, then we're just gonna have to see how well you can do on your own. Well, we know that would have been a failure on our part. But he didn't. He could have said, well, you can just hope that I'll listen and just kind of shout something to the sky and see what happens. But he didn't. No, he gave us the Holy Spirit, knowing that we don't know what we should pray for as we ought, who moans in groanings that cannot be uttered, so that our prayers can be given in heaven in a way that is acceptable. He also gave us, through the sweet-smelling savor of Jesus's life and his perfect ministry, a way where our prayers can ascend to heaven, like in the Old Testament sanctuary language, in above and through the veil. We know now that the veil is Jesus's body, since the tabernacle is no longer in play. But the point is, now we know we can enter into the presence of God through the righteousness of Jesus Christ, through the ministry of the Holy Spirit, making our prayers worthwhile. And now God can hear our prayers. And as I've said to you many times before, from a Hebrew perspective, hearing and acting, hearing and doing are synonymous. If God hears our prayer, like we sing the song, "Hear our prayer, O Lord, hear our prayer, O Lord, incline thine ear to us and grant us your peace." If God hears your prayer, he will also answer it. And so the hope and the desire is that God will hear our prayers. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I will say, in Isaiah chapter 59, verses 1 and 2, the Bible says that God doesn't have difficulty hearing our prayers. He does not have a problem with this. But sometimes, because of our lifestyles, the habit of our lives, it says that our iniquities have separated between us and our God, that he is not able to hear. So again, the whole goal is not just that we pray. I think sometimes we overemphasize our act of praying as though somehow that is meritorious. Somehow we can get God's attention. If we would just pray, then he'll pay attention. Well, it's true that we should pray and we ought not to faint. We should pray without ceasing. But the feature really is God's hearing our prayers, God's answering our prayers. And I'd like to recommend a book, actually, probably my favorite, I think it is, yes, my favorite book on prayer, and it is actually called On Prayer. That's the title, and it was written in the 1800s by a man named E.M. Bounds, E.M. Bounds on Prayer. So look that up when it's appropriate, and you will learn so much, just as I have, about prayer. And so tonight we are going to begin with what I call the seventh implement of war in the armor of God, the whole armor of God that is emphasized in Ephesians chapter 6, culminates with this principle of prayer. And it almost seems like an afterthought, and I'll come back to it after I read it in the text. It almost comes as an afterthought. You would think that it has nothing to do with the preceding verses. But Paul said, praying always, in verse 18, with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and all supplication for all saints. And so prayer in Paul's mindset was all-encompassing. Everything that is important in life must be filtered through prayer, because prayer was a lively connection between us and God, where we speak to God and he speaks to us. And as a young theology student said when I used to work in academic administration in university, he used to say, you know, when we pray, oftentimes we say, Lord, please speak to me, and then cover our ears. How can we ask God to speak to us? We're praying, we're speaking, we're allowing ourselves to meditate on his word and interact with God. How can we speak all the time in prayer and then close our ears to the answer? And so I think we should be investing and leaving some time available in our prayer sessions to hear from God. In the stillness, hear from God. Use his word as a way to hear his voice. Ask him, what does he have to say to me today? What do you have for me to hear today, God? And then just wait and allow the Holy Spirit to wash over you, at wave after wave of His Holy Spirit to wash over you, so that you can be enveloped in His truth, enveloped in His counsel, His guidance, in His wisdom. So prayer is not just me talking to God and speaking, because who would have that kind of conversation and it be fruitful? It's a two-way street. And as I said a little bit earlier, I call it the seventh implement of war in the whole armor of God principle in Ephesians chapter 6, because when you count down through the helmet and the feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace and the breastplate and everything else, the sword of the Spirit and everything else there, you count down through six implements. Now, I don't try to make more of something than is there, but God has a pattern. It's almost predictable. When He's sharing something perfect with us, He usually shares it in threes, tens, and sevens. And so when I counted years ago, I counted through those implements of the whole armor that we are to have on so we can quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. I came up with six, and I was dissatisfied, not with God's word, but I knew that there was something missing. There had to be something I was missing, because why would God break His predictable pattern when sharing something so wonderful? And then it hit me that maybe, just maybe, we have a habit of reading too quickly in His word. And when Paul ends this discussion of how to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one, he talked about praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and watching unto in all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Now the whole armor of God discussion has been completed. And so number seven in that array, the battle array, is prayer. None of the rest of what we read in that whole armor of God passage will be effective if we are not surrendered to God and listening for His voice in prayer. So just look at it and see if God says the same thing to you as you study or have a new look at Ephesians chapter 6 with the whole armor of God. Also, let me just say before we continue in the rest of our study, that once you look at every one of the implements there in Ephesians 6, you will see when he says put on this and put on that and put on the other, that each of them are Jesus Christ. Put on Jesus Christ. When it talks about salvation, through whom do we receive salvation? When it speaks of the Word of God, who is the Word of God? When it talks about our feet being shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, well, of whom is the gospel speaking? Is the gospel about me or a gospel about Jesus Christ? Salvation comes through whom only? And so if we go down through all of them, in whose name must we pray? Hitherto you've not asked anything in my name, Jesus said. If you ask in my name, it shall be given to you. Whether he said in one place, the Father shall give it, and then another place he said, I, meaning Christ, shall give it. And so all of it really makes sense now when Paul comes back in the book of Romans that we are to put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lusts thereof. And so God says, put on Christ and we will be safe. Put on Christ, come to God the Father in prayer, come to God in prayer through Christ, and we will be safe. If you want victory, that is the way to go. So we're going to have a few subtopics here, as we always do on Friday evenings. Number one, teach us to pray. That may be familiar to you. Secret prayer, prayer and victory, okay? So we're going to begin now with teach us to pray. And we're going to the book of Luke, and I hope that you are turning in your Bibles, because obviously I could put it up on the screen, but I am reluctant to do so because I would love for you to go ahead and do the searching. Even though I'm saying it, I'm speaking the text, and you can just sit and listen to me read it. I'm hoping that you will invest the time to turn in your pages or in your smart device to go to Luke chapter 11 and verse 1. And the Bible reads, "And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray as John also taught his disciples." Okay, and so they are witnessing, his disciples are witnessing him praying because he had a habit of pulling aside and praying to his Father in, you know, right before day. A great while before day, he would pray. And who knows what he would do throughout the day if the disciples ever saw him at some other point, not only at Gethsemane at the end of his life, but maybe they saw him praying at other times. And they wanted to know, well, Jesus, how is it that you have so much power? How is it that your connection is so lively with the Father? Can you show us how to get that? And the Bible says, all right, so I'm going to show you how to do that. And of course, then begins what we call the Lord's Prayer. And I'll just pause for a moment. We're not going to go down through the Lord's Prayer, but I do want to say something about how he begins. Oftentimes, we recite the Lord's Prayer as though it is our prayer. I'm not going to say anything negative about that, but that wasn't the intent when Jesus said, teach us how to pray. He wasn't saying, now repeat after me, say this, and that is your prayer. No, he was teaching us how to pray. And of course, we could use this prayer as a model. But as he begins, he said, when ye pray, say, our Father, which art in heaven. And so we are to identify early in our prayer that we are living on planet Earth. That means that we are earthly. That means that we have needs. That means that we are sinful, because everyone who's ever been born of a woman except Jesus Christ is born in sin, shapen in iniquity, and have cultivated and inherited tendencies toward evil. And we have sinned so many times we can't even count them. And therefore, we need God's guidance. We need his forgiveness. We need him to change us, transform our lives, because we have made a mess of our lives, right? And so he is saying now that we are identifying that our Father is in heaven. That is where there is only righteousness. That's where all righteousness dwells. When the devil and his angels were excommunicated, where they were evicted, the Bible says, rejoice ye heavens and they that dwell in them, for the devil is kicked out of here. And then, of course, he said, woe unto the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, because the devil has come down unto you having great wrath. And so in heaven, the place is pure. It is God's throne. Earth is his footstool. And so we are now to turn our minds, our eyes to where God is, to his holy hill. We are to look to Zion, where God is, and then know that hallowed be his name. He is holy. He is the only one that is holy inherently. God our Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, they are holy, and there in them is no darkness at all. But we are unholy, and so we laud the blessing of God's holiness, because we know that in him we can have life and have it more abundantly. Thy kingdom come, and I'll only use this verse here, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so we are delighted that God is not going to leave us down here to die. He's not going to leave us in the situation that earth is now. If you have turned on the news any at all during this week, or read the news in the Gleaner or Observer or whatever your newspaper is, if you have read anything about what's going on in the world, you know that we need God's will to be done on earth. We need to be hastening the kingdom of God to be his will manifest on earth as it is in heaven. And one day Jesus said that he would do this. He would do this. He's going to prepare a place for us, he said. And if he goes and prepares a place for us, he will come again and receive us unto himself, that where he is, we will be also. But after 1,000 years are finished following the coming of Jesus Christ, we will see the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a bride adorned for her husband. And that New Jerusalem will be set down on earth after all of wickedness is destroyed. And it will be on a great plain and take over that plain. And it will be the tabernacle of God that is with men, Jesus Christ himself. And then finally, the earth will be made new, according to Isaiah the prophet. And so that is part of the function of prayer. That is getting into the presence of our Father and then asking him in all of his holiness, in all of his mercy, in all of his grace, the fact that he loves us so much that he's done everything in order to save us. And then we begin, in our mindset of prayer so that we know he is holy, we are not. His ways are above our ways and greater in every way. And so from the book, The Thoughts from the Mount of Blessing, and actually this book is also titled The Greatest Sermon Ever Told. It's based on the Sermon on the Mount, which also includes the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5. The writer penned these words. It was from hours spent with God that he came forth morning by morning to bring the light of heaven to men. The disciples had come to connect his hours of prayer with the power of his words and works. Now, as they listened to his supplication, their hearts were awed and humbled. So they knew that it had to be prayer. You may have met great women, great men of prayer. Your grandfather, your grandmother, your close friend at work, your neighbor, the millionaire next door, who knows? I know people just like this who are obviously known by the feature of their lives, which is prayer. As he ceased praying, it was with a conviction of their own deep need that they exclaimed, "Lord, teach us how to pray." The disciples of John were taught by him to pray. Can you do that for us? And of course, Jesus did. Well, what example of prayer has our Savior left us? Well, I've already shared that in the quote, but I'm going to read, and by the way, that was from page 152. I'm going to read from Mark chapter 1. That's the book of Mark, chapter 1, and I am going to read in verse 35. Mark chapter 1, and I'm going to read in verse 35. And the Bible reads, "And in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place, and there he prayed a great while before day." Yeah, there are some of us who wake up just before it's time to get about our daily duties. You know, you got 30 minutes, 40 minutes, an hour left before everything has to happen, right? And some people get up like that and then wonder, why is it that I don't have any power for the day? I can tell you, even though I get up extremely early, if I neglect a moment of prayer, then I can see that evidenced in my day, and it's not a good thing. It is not pretty. And so the Bible is teaching us through Jesus's example that we should invest the time before we get about our daily duties, and not just a quick prayer. Put one knee down, "Lord, thank you for the day. Please forgive me for my sins. Bless my family. Amen," and push out. No, there are things that God wants to hear from us. Even though he already knows everything, he knows what we're going to say, he knows what we're thinking, but he wants us to speak those things. And in some cases, as who I call Auntie Ellen, Ellen G. White, as she says, that God grants an answer to the prayer of faith, that which he would not bestow, did we not thus ask? And I believe that is from the book Steps to Christ, page 49, but it's been such a long time since I've read it. And so God wants us to pray and not faint. And there, sometimes he increases our desire for the things for which we pray. He also puts us in a position where we need to humble ourselves and not know exactly when he's going to answer, so that we don't give up. We persist, we persevere. And so when God does give us our answer, we can more appreciate it. Why? Because we had to labor. We had to labor in prayer so that he would answer. And so it's also a lesson, a teaching tool. We're going to read also from the book of Luke. That's the book of Luke, chapter 5, and I will read verse 15 and 16. Luke chapter 5, verses 15 and 16. And the Bible reads, "But so much the more went there a fame abroad of him, and great multitudes came together to hear and to be healed by him of their infirmities." You're wondering why I'm reading this. I'll tell you in a moment. "And he withdrew himself into the wilderness and did what? Prayed." And so there was a fame about him that was going abroad. Everybody was speaking about Jesus. There were people who loved him and were showing his marvelous works, right, through the Spirit. In submission to his Father, he did exactly what he came to do. And there were people who could not help but to spread his name and say, "Hosanna in the highest." They wanted to elevate him to be king. But of course, it was not appropriate at the time. He should not have been elevated. There was a time where he did allow them, as he came into Jerusalem, the Bible calls it the triumphal entry, if you see the headings in that text, and Lazarus was leading the donkey and so forth. But apart from that time, Jesus did not allow people to so elevate him that it would disturb Caesar, if you want to say, the earthly government. He was there to do a specific work. That work was to save people from sinfulness, save people from the penalty and the presence of sin, the tendency towards sin. He was here to save us, right? But because of all of the great works that he did, though, it did put him in a position where he needed to pray even more. He needed to pray even more. So if you are doing things in ministry, and all of us must, all of us should if we are God's children, if you are doing things in ministry, then that should drive you more to pray. And when I say ministry, I'm not talking about the pulpit necessarily or pick a department in the church. I mean, anything that God has called you to do in order to edify people and to magnify him, that is ministry. And therefore, that puts us in a position that we need to be asking him more regularly than usual. "Lord, I don't know how to help this person. Lord, there are things that there are needs in my community, needs in my church, needs in my school, my workplace, needs at places I play and exercise and enjoy myself. There are needs all around. How should I satisfy those needs through the Holy Ghost? How, like, what is it that you need me to do? What is my part to play? And Lord, by the way, will you humble me? Because people keep thanking me when really you're the one who is due the honor and the praise and should be thanked for these great things. People keep on telling me how wonderful I am when really you're the only good one. People keep telling me that they can't wait until the next time I help them in this certain way. But really all good things, all perfect gifts come from you, the one who created us all. All of creation waits upon you." And you see how that conversation goes. And there was a woman like a mother to me, who said that, you know, when people have always told her wonderful things about herself, whenever she has helped them, she said she would take it with grace. And she would say, well, thank you, right? Thank you. And then when she went home to pray, before she would go to bed at night, she would say, "Lord, do you hear what these people said?" And she would go down through the times that people were giving thanks for the blessing that she would share with them, right? And she would say, "Did you hear this person say this? Lord, did you hear what this person said? Do you hear what they said about you, God? I give all of this to you. I set it at your feet. You're the one who is worthy of the praise that I received today. And I thank you for using me today." And I thought that was such an incredible practice, that she would give to God the glory. Sometimes people feel awkward, and really and truly, I don't want to be disrespectful, but really and truly, sometimes people say things about how we've been helpful and they thank us. And we say, and then we put his name in it and say, "Is good," right? "He's good. Isn't he good?" But really and truly, oftentimes people just say that because they feel awkward and they want to say, quote, the right thing, and they don't want to be seen as taking the glory to themselves. But really and truly, whether that's you or it is not, whether you say it or you do not, do you live glory to God? When you hear these things, are you saying, Lord, really, it is only you? It is only you. And this is something that we all need to be answering in our secret time with God in prayer. We'll talk about that in a little while. I'm also going to read now from the book of Luke chapter 6. Just go over one more chapter. Chapter 6, and I will read verse 12. Teach us to pray. Well, we know now part of the reason Jesus needed to pray so much was because people always elevated him, and he was so helpful in ministry, healing and raising people from the dead and all kinds of other ministry, encouraging people and teaching the word of God, that he needed extra prayer so he could be victorious. And the Bible reads in verse 12, Luke chapter 6, and it came to pass in those days that he went out into a mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. So what is this text saying? Is it saying that we always need to be praying all night? Well, no, because if we prayed all night every night, then when would we sleep, right? When would we rest? But there are times that are so critical in our lives that we do need to consider what kind of praying, what level of petition do we need? And sometimes that will drive us to our knees through the night season, agonizing with God and giving him thanks for hearing our prayers. And so we see the example with Jesus Christ. I'm going to read also from the book of Luke. We're still here in the book of Luke, so just a few pages over. Luke chapter 3. Verses 21 and 22, still on the concept of Jesus teaching us. Not only did he speak some words to his disciples about how to pray, but they could have seen through his example in Luke chapter 3, verses 21 and 22, the Bible reads, and when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also being baptized and praying, the heavens was opened. And the Holy Ghost descended in a bodily shape like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven, which said, thou art my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. And so the question is, well, what was Jesus doing when he received the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Have you ever heard a sermon preached on this? Maybe you have, but likely you have not. Have you ever even paused and noticed and made note of what was happening here? So Jesus was baptized. And we talk about often how the voice from heaven, God our Father, says, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. We often and always talk about when the Holy Spirit came down in bodily form and hovered over the place and then lighted upon Jesus, and appropriately so. And we talk about Jesus coming up out of the water before all of this, and he will have now fulfilled all righteousness. But do we ever pause to look at the fact that Jesus was also being baptized and praying before the heaven opened? Jesus was praying, and a part of the answer to his connection to God, our Father, in prayer was everything that I described just now and more. So from the book Desire of Ages, I'd like to read a little passage. It reads, upon coming out of the water, Jesus bowed in prayer on the riverbank. The Savior's glance seems to penetrate heaven as he pours out his soul in prayer. Have you ever noticed that? When he knows how sin has hardened the hearts of men and how difficult it will be for them to discern his mission and accept the gift of salvation, he pleads with the Father for power to overcome their unbelief, to break the fetters with which Satan has enthralled them, and in their behalf to conquer the destroyer. He asks for the witness that God accepts humanity in the person of his Son. Well, what happens? Of course, God answers that prayer. Never before have the angels listened to such a prayer. They are eager to bear to their loved commander a message of assurance and comfort. But no, the Father himself will answer. Hallelujah. He will answer the petition of his Son. Direct from the throne issue the beams of his glory. The heavens are opened, and upon the Savior's head descends the dove-like form of purest light, fit emblem of him, the meek and lowly one. There are times that the father has to do things all his own. Yes, we can see when Daniel was distraught and distressed for 21 days he prayed. And of course, he needed an answer. And God had already mixed and prepared the answer, and he was going to send that answer to him. But the Bible says that Gabriel was held back. He was held back, and then Michael, Jesus Christ himself, he came and relieved Gabriel and let him go down and provide the answer that God had already provided all from the beginning of his supplications. And so in that case, we see Gabriel being the one, the bearer of good news. You are beloved, Daniel. And then he gave him skill and all of the things that he needed. But this time, when Jesus prayed, God our Father, that is not to minimize the ministry of angels. That is not to minimize when the Father sends them to do his bidding. That is not to minimize that. But when God our Father himself does something so spectacular, we need to take note. And he himself, he said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And it's such a blessing to see the God our Father at work. And so I'm going to go into the concept now of secret prayer. Secret prayer in our few minutes. We have just under 20 minutes. Secret prayer. We're going to the book of Matthew, chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, and I am going to read verses 5 and 6. Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 and 6. And the Bible reads, "And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites." And this is a lesson that we must get, and I think sometimes we misapply it just a little bit. Let's see if we can glean the truth from it. "We shall not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men." So the function here that God is trying to take away from our pride is to do things to be seen of men. That doesn't mean that if you pray in public, that somehow that's wrong. Well, clearly we do it in church often now, don't we? I know that there are details here about this prayer that are different than what we do in church, but I'm just saying. So don't focus so much on the where or the location of the praying, but now look at the motive of the ones praying, the hypocrites that are praying. He said, "Do not pray so you can be seen by people." Don't do it. Even if you're quiet, even if you're not speaking aloud, even if you're somewhere drawing aside or you're about to, right? Even if it's that you know, you're in a place with someone and or a group of people and you want to just announce that you're going to pray in order for them to be like, "Oh, you're going to pray now?" Like, don't do it. I'm not saying you can't announce it. Who am I to say? I'm just saying, don't do anything so that you can be seen. Because the Bible says here, Jesus speaking, "Verily I say unto you, they have their reward." So if somebody congratulates you and gives you a clap, "Oh, he or she is so pious. Look at how holy they are." That's your reward. So really, you've burned your time, or I, God forbid, have burned my time there, because the blessing that I'm seeking in prayer, well, I'm not going to get that, because all I really wanted was somebody to see me. And they saw me, they clapped me, they said, "Congratulations." And they said, "Boy, look at how holy he is." Well, that's my reward. And of course, that is not enough, because that is not the point of prayer. Verse 6, "But when you pray, enter into thy closet." That is your secret place. We're talking about now individual prayer, despite what I have just said, just to make a point. "And when thou prayest, shut thy door. Pray to the Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth thee in secret shall reward thee openly." We will see the manifestation of our secret prayers in our public lives. Let me say it again. We will see the manifestation of our secret prayer lives in our public visible lives. Thank God. And so if you want to be known by anything, then be known by the Holy Spirit being in your life, boasting in the Lord, in the Lord only, and letting the manifestation of God's power come through in your life because you have invested in prayer. And God, because he loves to answer his children's prayers, will have answered, and people can see that. Well, let's also read in the book of Luke. We're going back to the book of Luke. Clearly, there is a lot there that is beneficial to us about this subject. Luke chapter 9, and I will read at verse 18. Of course, it's only a partial connection to what we're saying. And it came to pass, as he was alone praying, his disciples were with him, and he asked them, saying, whom do people say that I am? And then, of course, he has this great discussion about who he actually is. Then they see a manifestation of the Holy Ghost there as the disciple answered rightly, and we can see how God was leading in that situation. But he was alone praying. Jesus had a habit of praying alone because he knew he could not manage this life without communing with his Father. I did not say speaking to his Father. I said communing. It was a two-way street. God is speaking to Jesus. Jesus is speaking to him. Jesus is meditating on the Word, and the Word of God speaks to him in truth so that he can know what he should do. And I know that that sounds interesting because Jesus, after all, is our creator, but he condescended. He took on human form. And for 33 and a half years, Jesus had to rely on God, our Father, in the same way that we must. And where it comes on to getting through his earthly experience, where there were temptations, he needed his Father to get him through it and the Holy Ghost. Where there were trials, he needed his Father and the Holy Ghost. When he was hungry, he needed to rely on his Father to provide for him, just as we do. When he needed to rest at night, he needed his Father to protect him, just as we do. And so it's a blessing to see this the holiest of all, like to come down in human form and not cheat. He did not come down here and then utilize some strength of his own in order to be victorious over sin in his own circumstance. No, he relied on God as Father so that when the tempter came, he could find, meaning the tempter, could find nothing in him. No answering cord, because Jesus had a habit of connecting with his Father. And I'm so thankful. And I hope you've heard this, because sometimes people think Jesus's victory was assigned or associated because of his divinity. Well, no, that would be unfair. We don't possess that quality. So his victory had to do with his submission to his Father and the power of the Holy Spirit. We're going to read now in 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 2. That's the book of 1 Timothy chapter 2, and just about 10 minutes left here. And we'll read verse 8. 1 Timothy chapter 2, and we will read in verse 8. And the Bible reads, I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. I will therefore that men, of course, and women pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. We can see in the Old Testament when God was really getting after his people for a false kind of fasting, that they would, fast in a way that everybody would watch them and say, boy, look at them fast, and, make themselves look all somber and drawn down and whatever. And he said, is this the kind of fasting that I accept? Because they were also oppressing people. They also overlooked people who were in need. They also desecrated the holy seventh-day Sabbath. And he said, the fast that I accept is that you should deliver the oppressed, that you should not do the things that you are doing to them, that you should keep the Sabbath holy, the seventh-day Sabbath holy, and so forth, not to just do these things so that people can see you, not to just do these things so people can say, boy, these persons are pious and holy. No, that is not fasting. I don't care how when the last time you ate was. That is not fasting. And so here we see that he wants us also to be without wrath and doubting. As he said to the Old Testament people, stop doing these wicked things against others. Here, avoid wrath, avoid doubt, hold up holy hands. In the Old Testament, stop doing things with your hands to people to strangle the life out of their spirituality and their earthly livelihood. Your hands need to be clean. If we are praying, our hands need to be clean. Our lives is really what it's talking about. And of course, the Bible also says, not only do we pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands and everything that we've just described, but he also said, pray without ceasing. Now, I want to pause here just for a moment on that concept or principle of praying without ceasing. Enoch was a good example. The Bible says that he walked with God. Was it that God abandoned all that he was doing around the universe and he came down and physically walked with Enoch every day, all day long? Well, it's not exactly that. It is that everything that Enoch did, he sought the Lord's guidance. Everything that Enoch did, he sought the Lord's guidance. And a person who is well connected with God and is always seeking his face is walking with God. And if we're seeking his face, that means that we are in a lively connection with him, and really and truly a lively connection with him, asking him and hearing from him is prayer. It's a lifestyle of prayer. Yes, there is a kind of prayer that we kneel down and we speak to him that way. Yes, there is a kind of prayer where we look up to heaven and we even spread forth our hands to signify our surrender and our willingness to receive that which God is blessing us with, right? That is true, but there is a kind of walking around prayer. Somebody is speaking to you. You're at the gym or wherever you happen to be. Someone is speaking to you and they're asking you a question. And in that moment you say, Lord, how am I supposed to help this person? What am I supposed to say? What am I supposed to do? What should I refrain from saying? What should I refrain from doing? And it is there that we are living prayer. And so when we pray without ceasing, we are really just opening up ourselves to hear from God in all circumstances, at all times of the day, even when we are not bowed down on our knees, which, you know, there are times that we should often and obviously do when we have the opportunity. And so secret prayer is a key feature in the life of every believer. Now I want to talk to you briefly about prayer and victory. Prayer and victory. Well, when and upon what condition really has God promised to hear our prayer? And of course there are many, but there's one in the Old Testament I'd like to highlight, and it is familiar to many of you already. So hopefully in your mind, you are reciting this truth as Solomon was rebuilding the temple, and now he's there to dedicate this temple to God. But he's praying. And he's confessing the sins of his people. He's confessing his sins. And the power of God came over the place so heavily that they couldn't even minister. The priests couldn't even minister in the sanctuary because the presence of God was so heavy. And that's a positive thing because God was answering the prayer. But here it is. If my people, verse 14 of 2 Chronicles chapter 7, if my people, which are called by my name, are you called by God's name? Are you one of his children? Have you surrendered your will to him? Shall humble themselves. We need to call on his name and humble ourselves. What else? Pray. So don't stop praying. And seek his face. Don't stop seeking God's face and turn from their wicked ways. Always be in a position, a mind frame of what? Repentance. Never turn your back on God, but rather turn your back on sin and turn from their wicked ways. Then the Bible says, I will hear from heaven. Then I will forgive their sin, and then I will heal their land. And so we have such an incredible promise from God himself, even in the Old Testament, to see the kind of victory that we can receive, forgiveness of sin. We can be healed. We can be in the mind frame that we are constantly what? Doing what? Turning from our wicked ways, constantly turning the shoulder against sin. And in that way, when Jesus does return, he will see a person in your case and in mine. He will see a person who has dedicated themselves to hearing from him, speaking to him, and then following the instructions that he gives in answer to prayer. And I'm so thankful because There are so many of us who just wonder, is God listening? Of course he's listening. He said he would listen. Is he going to answer? Of course he's going to answer. He said he would answer. And so when we call upon the Lord, I think we're going to just end here with the few minutes that we have. When we call upon the Lord in our times of trouble, what has he promised? I love that word, promised to do when we call upon the Lord. Well, I'm going to the book of Psalms, and you could have anticipated that because so many times we read about calling upon the Lord in the book of Psalms. And I will read 107, the 107th division of the Psalms, verse 6. And I will read now. Then they cried unto the Lord in their trouble. And what did he do? God's people, read the rest of the verses that come before. We are almost out of time. And he delivered them out of their distresses. And if you have been following with the Sabbath school lesson, the adult Sabbath school lesson for our Seventh-day Adventist church, you will note that God came through for his people in the study of the book of Nehemiah. There were times that we did exactly what he said. I'm saying we because we're a part of God's people today too. We did what God said, and there were times that we did not. And then he would come through with mercy, and we would do what he said, and then we would do not or not do. And the Bible says that through his great mercy, he continued to answer their cries and delivered them. And it was such a blessing upon their lives that the entire world, even in 2019, can look back at the testimony of what it looks like when God's people are aligned with him. So we see that there is power and victory in prayer. We know that there was power in secret praying. And then, of course, Jesus taught us how to pray. There is so much more we could say, but of course, that would take weeks of study, and we could do that, but we're going to go ahead and pause right here. God delights to answer our prayers. He loves to hear us speak to him. He loves to speak back to us, and we need to be investing our time in prayer. I never tell you usually what we're going to do the next week. We're going to pray in a moment, but next week, Lord sparing life, we will continue in our study with part number 9, examples of victory through prayer. We want to see some people who have been victorious. Let's go ahead and pray, and I'll let you go. Father in heaven, thank you for the blessing of prayer, and not just prayer, but we're thanking you for being on the other end of that prayer telephone, that you are there to hear our prayer. And you are inclining your ear to us. You are granting us your peace. And I thank you. And I'm asking you now, Father, that if you would you please teach us how to pray? Will you teach us how to pray without ceasing? Will you teach us how to pray through our temptations? Because the disciples failed as you, Jesus, pardon me, was in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he was there praying. And they should have watched with him in prayer, but they didn't. But Jesus came through that trial with victory. Help us to do that because the tempter has asked to have us to sift us as wheat. Help us to experience the answer to the prayer Jesus prayed. But I have prayed for you that your faith fail you not. Please make us recipients of your grace through prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen again. I would like to thank you for investing this time with us and welcome you to our daily Bible class, which is really the Sabbath school lesson in small bites, just 10 minutes every single morning at the Central Jamaica Conference of Seventh-day Adventists Facebook page. We are live every single morning at 5 a.m. Jamaica time. Hopefully, you can get up and enjoy that time with us. But until tomorrow morning, Lord sparing life, I'd just like to say peace and blessings. Have a wonderful rest of your evening. In Jesus' name, peace.